Good morning, Mount View Christian Church. I've got a few announcements I'm going to go over. But first, if you're a visitor here and you see these yellow cards, if you would you fill them out and at the end of the service, just leave them in your chair. We'll pick them up. That gives us record that you've been here. It allows us to pray for you over the week. And if you have a special prayer that you need for somebody or for yourself, just write that down on there, and that'll give us a record, and let us pray for you that week. On our announcements, the Operation Christmas Child was a huge success. Praise God for the blessings that we have followed the OCC ministry. Thank you so much who all participated in that. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, that was the record amount that we've ever drawn on the chili cook-off and all that, the auction. So it was a great deal. Youth Mission Monday, November 6th at 1 p.m. This Monday, all youth are encouraged to help cut firewood for those in need this Monday, November 6th. Meet at the church at 1 p.m. So kids, get your gloves and your hard work ethic and bring it to church. Mount View Christian Church Board will be the 13th, be 6 p.m. Men's Fellowship is at Houston, November 13th. All men are invited to attend. There will be food, worship, and fellowship. And if any man has not ever been to a men's fellowship, they're missing out on mainly a really good meal and a good message. WOW, meeting December 3rd at 9 a.m., all ladies are invited to gather and discuss the plan for the upcoming events and outreaches. It'll be in room 106. Youth Christmas Party, December 13th at 6 to 8 p.m. The annual youth Christmas party will be at the Youth Center on Wednesday, December 13th from 6 to 8. Please drop off and pick up your students at the Youth Center. Students will bring a snack or dessert to share and a stuffed animal or a comfort item to be donated to foster care children. So that's a good ministry there. Team 412 and the Youth Christmas Program and meal will be December the 20th. There will be a church-wide meal service by the youth at 6 p.m. followed by a short Christmas program performed by the Team 412 students. If you've never been to one of those, that's another one that you really need to come to, guys, because these little guys put their heart and soul into this program. So you get a good meal and you get awesome entertainment. Really, they're really good. A candlelight service will be December 24th from 6 to 7 p.m. So mark that on your calendar, guys. It's a great thing. We'll be hosting a candlelight service Sunday, Christmas Eve night. Everyone is welcome, and invite your family and friends to join us as we worship the Lord and Savior and celebrate his birth. So if you've got family coming in and you're intending to come to this anyway, load them up and bring them on up here. We got room. And a high school lock-in will be December 31st. There'll be a lock-in for the grades 9 through 12 on New Year's Eve. Plan to attend. It's from 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. Bring a snack and share lots of friends. Okay. Anyway, I'll pray us in and we'll get started. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful, beautiful day that you've given us to enjoy, to worship you. Lord, we ask that you would be with Sister Lacey and this crew as they bring the music, not only to us, but to you, Lord. Be with Brother Barry as he brings the communion meditation to open our hearts and our mind just to prepare to take the emblems. And be with Brother Eric as he brings your word to us. Help us to distribute it out to others that just don't know you. Be with the ones that's sick on this list. Be with the ones that's just not feeling good. Lord, you know their needs, and we just ask that you would be with them. We lift them up to you. Again, be with this service. We thank you so much for being patient with us and for loving us like you do. And I ask it all through the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together this morning. just going to tell y'all a little inside information here. We had a little miscommunication between myself and Eric on the topic of today's message. And sometimes when I know, you know, what he's going to speak on, I will try to find some music that will help support that. Well, I know we were going to be, he's going to start a sermon series on kind of eternity, right? And I thought that today he was going to be preaching about heaven. However, when we get to the sermon, you're going to find out that I was a little mistaken. But it's okay, because it's good to sing about heaven, whether that's what Eric is preaching on today or not. And when I think about heaven, I tend to think about this hymn, because from some of the descriptions we have in Scripture, this is what we hear. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our song shall rise to Blessed Trinity. join with the saints and the angels around your throne this morning, singing, "Worthy is the Lamb, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, who was and who is to come." We commit ourselves to you this morning. We commit our lives, our future, our present, our past into your hands, our Lord and our Savior. We glorify you and we lift you up. There is no one like you. You alone are to be exalted and feared and praised and honored and adored. We give you our thanks. We give you our worship this morning. We thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, and it is in him we stand and in whom we pray. Amen. Amen. You can be seated this morning, church. Let's just prepare our hearts to receive the Lord's Supper this morning.
Good morning, church. Y'all may not get to hear Eric's sermon about heaven if the good Lord don't quit putting new thoughts in my head this morning, because on the way home from OCC yesterday, where we took some high schoolers to an event, Eric was kind of putting some finishing touches on his sermon. Most of the others were asleep. A few of them were singing along with what we had on the radio to keep from sleeping. Well, in my head, I was running through, okay, communion meditation tomorrow. All right, got some ideas. This is where I'm going with this one. Kind of had it all mapped out in my head. Was pretty confident on that when I went to sleep last night, so didn't think about it anymore. Well, then morning came, and something else came on the radio, and something struck my head, and so the common theme I've figured out is music and worship, because that's every thought that keeps coming through my head. And it was even a couple days ago it came back to me. If you listen to K-Love, they've been having a throwback celebration where they're playing like 80s and 90s worship music. And of course, that's what I grew up to when I was listening to that music and wasn't doing something I shouldn't have been doing. Not that all their music's bad, but didn't always listen to what I should have. And my dad would attest to that, because as a music teacher, he wasn't very happy with some of the things I chose to listen to and participate in sometimes. But again, there's one of those references. My dad was a music teacher. What are the odds of that? And my life has revolved around worship and music and ministry. And I think it's because of that. And you know, I just think back about many things, but there's Michael W. Smith's song called Friends. I'm sure some of y'all know that song. It comes on the radio, and I'm tearing up on the radio, because you know what I remember? I remember standing on a church stage with three other junior high school students. The four of us had a little singing group, and that's what we did. And then I thought about, this weekend, we talked about Acts, was the message Michael DeFazio presented. And basically, Acts brings us into Jesus' ministry. And I think I have a slide up there, Corey. Maybe we'll go ahead and throw it up there. I wasn't sure when I'd need it, but we'll just put it up there now. And he brought up this point. And this will be a topic of discussion later, because you guys want to go home today. But we'll get into Acts at some point and talk about this ministry of Jesus and where it was going. But the theme was that we are the continuation of the ministry of Jesus. You know, basically, that was where Jesus was handing it over. Say, all right, guys, here it is. Well, gee, what did he do in that handing over process? He brought them to the table. He said, okay, this is my body, this is my blood. And so I'm thinking through all of this the whole time. It just keeps coming back. And so I went back to that and this continuation and things through your life. And, you know, I mentioned my dad and the music teaching. Mom was the one who usually was on me about going to church when I didn't want to go to church. I liked church, but I'd find other things to do different times. And like a lot of other people in college, you know, had better things to do. So I strayed away a little bit. Was always there when I could be, but not a priority. Not going to say that's changed in my adult life at times. You know, there may be reasons I let work get in my way, other things get in my way. Maybe my pride and my temper. Maybe somebody made me mad last week. None of them are good excuse, but they're all ones we come up with every time. But I think back to this continuation, and then the music thing. And so as children, your children, we're children, we're all children, we're God's continuation of life. Jesus, we're supposed to be his continuation. Well, you know, our kids are our continuation, right? So I brought up my parents. Well, then I have my children coming through. So as I've thought about this, and I apologize, this is going to go on and on and on, but it just keeps coming into my head. You know, Lindsay and I were married 25 years. In May, we started youth ministry at her home church the week we came off of our honeymoon. Continuation, right? So then we got into music ministry. Well, then years ago at Summers when we first moved here, there's a few people here that will remember that. I had a little girl about this size wanting to get up and sing with me. You know, I was a chicken a lot of times, didn't want to get up and do things like that. But when you have somebody like that, that inspires you. So it gets you just more into life, more into continuation. You guys experienced her growth through that. And she's way more talented than I'll ever be. But it just breaks my heart, or not breaks my heart, joys my heart, you know, to see that continuation. The blessings that God has given me throughout life. And the other thing that he said, God delights in you. He said, God delights in you. No matter where you're at, God delights in you. Man, that clicked with me too. It's like, so even all those times I've been stubborn, prideful, stupid, hateful, aggravated, whatever it was, God still delighted in me. He still wanted me to be here. And the rewards are always in front of you. And this was maybe a little flashback in history and life for me, but I just keep seeing them, and I see that continuation. And so I got to thinking about how old I was getting as all these kids were up front screaming at the music, you know, which was a little louder than I probably really wanted it to be and a little more obnoxious. But when you see 500-600 kids up front jumping up and down with their arms in the air, and I've been to countless youth events over the years, there's nothing probably that moves me more than that moment, because they don't care. I'm not going to tell you they were all there for the right reasons. Some of them were there with their friends. Some of them were just up there because they wanted to act stupid and goofy. But I guarantee you there were some kids there that were absolutely in love with the Lord, knew their calling in life, knew where their future was going, and just wanted to be up there praising God. And you know, we've often talked about that at the church sometimes. So, you know, I was thinking about that this morning. We had a very worshipful, slower service, so to speak, compared to what we were at in Joplin this week. But I love it all, because that's the blessing of having a dad for a music teacher. He just introduced me to so many different things. I appreciate a lot of it and all of it. But then I had this thought, and it's going to sound judgmental. Why aren't we all up here standing at the stage jumping up and down when we have worship service? The kids are doing it right. We've actually said this before from this pulpit, but the kids have it figured out. You know, and I'm not saying we can't be joyful where we're at, jumping up and down and singing and everything. But I just, like I said, the thing just keep coming and coming and coming in my head. And so when I started this yesterday, my opening thought was Heart of Worship. I've always loved that song. And my favorite line in that song is when the music fades and all is stripped away. Right here is where you need to be. And as we were through that week, this is going to take y'all back to an older time here a little bit, because we're going to do something unique this morning. Surprise, I'm going to do something different for communion meditation. I know people use that as a joke, so I just use it as a joke anymore too. But how many of you remember when we used to do, I forget the exact name of them, but I want to say it was resuscitative readings, but it might have been repetitive readings. I don't remember what they were called, but we'd read responsive readings. That's the R word I wanted. Thank you, whoever's out there. I got too much in my head to get them all out there this morning. So we used to do that. I remember that as a kid. I don't know if I ever remember doing it here. We've been here, 12 years or so. I don't know if we've ever done that. I can't remember, but I'm sure y'all did it somewhere back in the day. Another one of those historical moments was when we were on this trip to OCC, Lindsay and Eric and I realized that in 12 years, that was the first time the three of us had ever been together on a youth trip with kids. Usually it was one or two or any combination, but we'd never all three went on the trip. So that was kind of one of those nostalgic, weirdly neat things too. But anyway, we used to do these responsive readings. So this morning, I don't think we've ever done this song. I could be wrong, Lacey. Abide. Have we done the song Abide? Not the hymn, but the newer version. Seth Williamson, I believe, who does it. I don't think we have. But anyway, it's a popular new worship song. So your guys' part is really easy, okay? And you can say it however you want. You have a repetitive line. It's, I depend on you, I depend on you. Or you can say, I depend on Christ, I depend on Christ. You can make it your own, so to speak. But I'm going to do part of this, and then when I stop and I say I, then you all jump in with either depend on you or depend on me. Some of you are going to know this song. You've heard it on the radio. I'm going to probably attempt to sing it a little bit, because I'm not sure I can just read it and do it justice. So just bear with me, but that's how I want to bring us to the table this morning, because the words in this song probably tie together what I've rambled about for the last 5 minutes better a little together, at least of the specifics of why we're here and what we're supposed to be. So if you'll indulge me on this and just come in where you can, and so I don't actually read the words wrong, I'll put my old man glasses on, look real professional and all that. So it's amazing how much bigger they are when you do that. So so again, y'all can sit, you can stand, whatever you want to do, but this is a worship session, guys. We talk about laying our burdens down, bringing our problems to the cross, and that's exactly what we need to do. But this is the most intimate worship we can ever have with our Lord and Savior, that's coming to this table. And I think this song really sums it up really well. And of course, I'm not much with technology, so I just shrunk the words down where I couldn't even see them with my glasses. But so anyway, the song's called Abide. Like I said, just fall in where you will. For my waking breath, for my daily bread, I depend on you. That's your part. I depend on you for the sun to rise, for my sleep at night. I depend on you. I depend on you. Where the Spirit leads, as I'm following, I depend on you. I depend on you for the victories still in front of me. I depend on you. I depend on you. When I pass through death, as I enter rest, I depend on you. I depend on you for eternal life, to be raised with Christ. I depend on you. I depend on you. If you know the chorus, join in with me. You're the way, the truth, and the life. You're the well that never runs dry. I'm the branch and you are the vine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Be my strength, my song in the night. Be my treasure, all my prize. I am yours forever, you're mine. Draw me close and teach me to abide. Thanks for indulging me, guys. Join us with the supper.
I will take full responsibility for Lacey not knowing where I'm going. And I'll give you my reasoning. Are you ready for it? I thought to myself, well, next Sunday is the first Sunday in November, and guys can't go out into their tree stands on Sunday morning. However, the following Sunday, they can. So perhaps I should give you something to think about what you are saved from next week in case you happen to skip church. Whether the story is true or not, I don't know. I don't know. There lived a gentleman one day, was carrying out his business in his home. And he goes, smells like fire. Smells like fire. Now, this was before technology and before electronic mail. The guy sits down at his table, pulls out a postcard, and writes to the local fire department. There's a smell of fire in my home. And puts it in the mailbox. The next morning, the fire department gets it, and they think it's a joke. Who would take time and... But, because they wanted to be humored, they went to the gentleman's house to find it actually smoldering in a blaze. That prompted the men into action. And within minutes, they had the home extinguished. The man actually was fortunate that he had not lost the entire home. This morning, as you and I look at hell, as we dive into hell, I'm gonna say hell a few times, okay? It's on the front of your bulletin. It's in the Bible. It's a Bible word. I'm gonna say it, okay? It seems weird, but friends, whatever we believe of hell, whatever, wherever you stand on the subject of it, the truth is the Bible undeniably states that there is some form of something called hell. And you and I, God has called us to partner with Him as He rescues and saves people out of the fire before it is all ablaze. You and I are firefighters and the family of God. Let us shine as people. Let us shine as people with both our actions and our words. One of the things that Michael DeFazio talked about yesterday, and that is 100% true, and we've got to understand and we've got to delicately do it. But there's this little scripture that says that you need to speak the truth in love. And figuring out where that place is, because we can't go too far in truth and we can't go too far in love. We go either direction and people are not going to hear Jesus. But here's the truth of Scripture. Paul, when writing to the church at Ephesus in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 16, he says these words, "Make the most of every opportunity because the days are evil." And in fact, if you have a different version besides the NIV, he says, "Make the most of your time." Now, I've shared this before, but I want to share it again as we go through this scripture right here. Now, that word for opportunity or the word for time, in the Greek, there are two words for time. One is chronos. Chronos is the clock on the back wall. Chronos is the one that says this morning, sometime around 2 o'clock, your phones went back to 1 o'clock. And you got an extra hour of sleep. I got an extra hour of sleep because I only had about 4 hours the night before. Because by the time we got to the room and I got up in the morning to run with my son, I got about 4 hours of sleep. But then there's the other one, and that's the one that we really need to hold on to, and that's the one that Paul talks about right here. There's the kairos time. Those are moments. Right now, we are having a kairos moment where we're opening God's word together. There are moments in your walk. There are moments through your daily week that you have kairos moments with people. Paul says, don't waste those. Why does he say not to? Because the days are evil. In fact, in 2 Timothy, Paul reminds the young Timothy that in the last days, people are going to be lovers of ... And he gives a whole list. And it boils down to the number one, people are going to be lovers of self. I'm going to love me more than you. Now, if God said, I love me more than you, he would have never sent Jesus Christ. If God says, I love me more than you, he would have just done away with Adam and Eve at the very beginning and been done with it. But God says, I love you this much. I'm going to make a way. I love you this much. Jesus' work on the cross was truly to bring salvation to all mankind, which I believe and I'm going to preach until I die. And we need to be reminded this morning as we talk about eternity of what we are saved from before we can talk about what we're saved to. Because there's no appreciation of what we are saved to if we forget what we're saved from. And then the tail end of the month, we're going to look at an illustration of being ready, and then an illustration from the book of Luke on heaven and hell. But please make no mistake this morning, friends. If you feel urged by the Holy Spirit, yes, that's the Holy Spirit convicting you deep inside, saying, respond to the gospel message. I pray today would be your day of salvation. I pray that you don't delay. Because here's the truth. Whether you smell it or not, the smoke is burning. And if you don't know Jesus, it's going to be engulfed. The truth of the matter is, and here's the interesting thing about hell, Jesus didn't really talk much about it. Like 13 times in all four Gospels do we find the word hell. In the New Testament, there are actually three words for it, and we're going to get there in a few moments, but there are three words in the New Testament for hell. Jesus only uses two of them. And we need to take them very carefully, very thoughtfully, and very seriously. When it comes to life after this one, there are three popular opinions out there on what happens to you and I after we die. One of those opinions is this. It's called, normally held as eternal conscientious torment. I have those three opinions up there. Eternal conscious torment. I should have put torment after that. The second one is conditional immortality. And the third is ultimate reconciliation. Now, those are the technical terms for them. Let me put them in layman's terms for us because this, like, that's how I operate, okay? The first one, eternal conscientious torment. That's what you and I have always, like, been taught, or that's what we believe about hell. Literally, after this life is over, you're either with Jesus for all eternity or you are burning somewhere for all eternity. And after all, we find the terminology of it in Revelation 14, Revelation 20, and Matthew 25. We find it in Scripture. In the Western churches where we've grown up, we've grown up in the Western church, okay, and I'm just going to tell you that, guys, okay? It's this place of fiery pit, this place of eternal torment, this place of weeping and gnashing of teeth, and it's constantly, and it's all the time, and it's for all eternity. Now, sometimes to me, 5 minutes can seem like an eternity. I have no idea what an eternity feels like. I've never been there. But then there's the second, conditional immortality, which is commonly referred to as annihilation. This means after a short period of time, you are going to be wiped out, gone. As I was thinking through it, the best example I can give, and I know I'm only going to get about half of my audience here, if you've watched the Marvel movies, if you have not watched the Marvel movies, you're not going to get this reference. However, if you have, you're going to get it. All right, the main antagonist, Thanos, gets this glove, and it's got all these stones in it. This is the gist of it. And with all these stones, he snaps his finger and wipes out half of all the universe. And then for the next sequence, you watch all these people just to dust and into the wind. Dust in the wind. Heard that song too. That's annihilation. You're going to spend some time there in the fiery pits, but then after some time, you're just not going to exist. And then finally, the third is ultimate reconciliation, or what we like to call universalism. You might spend a little bit of time in a fiery pit, but ultimately you're not going to be wiped out. Ultimately, God's going to reconcile you to him. Which means it doesn't matter how you live on earth, at some point you'll have to pay for it a little bit. And listen, my heart goes, that's the way I wished it would be. Because there are times when I do stupid stuff and I'm like, how could he ever forgive that stupidity? Like, we want that. People want that. It makes us feel easier about our lives that God's just going to, it's going to be okay. He'll just save us all. Here's the problem. Universalism, you have to twist scripture to make it fit. You have to twist it. You have to take it out of context to make it fit. And remember, the first thing in Bible study, guys, is context is king. You cannot put the content in before the context. And so to the universalist, and I'm sure that there's somebody who's going to watch this online and they're going to attack me for that statement. I'm okay with that. To the universalist idea, though, we hear things in our society like this one phrase, this common phrase. And I realize I put it in there out of order, but it's okay, Corey. People say this one line. Are you ready? I can't believe that a loving God would do what? Send anyone to hell. He's not going to do it. How can an all-loving God send anyone to hell? And they hang on this. Enoch is right. You know, if you were here with us last week, Enoch talked about how we were coming home from district and he and I were listening. What he really meant was that was my dad was finishing listening to the book Erasing Hell that he had already started this week. And I got to finish the last couple of chapters with him before I fell asleep. That's what Enoch really meant to say. By Francis Chan and Preston Sprinkle, and they talk about this for a little bit in their book, Erasing Hell. Now, while there are many times in the people that God does not love our actions, God does love us. That is absolutely 100% true. And when it comes down to God's desires, we find two places in the New Testament that really talks about God's desire. One of those is in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. Now, let me preface this. Right off the bat, with right there in chapter 2, verse 1, Paul tells Timothy to pray for everybody. Now, he says to pray that you will live a unified life. Pray for your leaders. Pray for those in authority that you may live a tranquil life. And then he gets down to verse 4. And I know I have the scripture up there. Look at what he says in verse 4. This is good and pleasing. Pleases God our Savior who does what? Wants all people to be and to come to of the truth. God desires, he wants all people to be saved. He wants all people to know and come to know Jesus Christ. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. God is so patient with us. Corey, if you could put those verses up there for me, the next set of verses. 2 Peter, yep. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. You ever stop and you go, oh, yeah, to God, one day is like 1,000 days, 1 year is like a... No, one day is like 1,000 years. That's a lot of one days. And 1,000 years like one day. And the Lord is not slow in keeping his promises. So when you and I go, okay, God, you can come back anytime now. That's like our patience has run out, but his has not yet. Okay? The Lord is not slow in keeping his promises as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish. But that all would come to repentance. That all would come to repentance. And so I believe that 100% God's desire this morning is that you and I would understand, that you and I would hear, and if we have not yet, that we would respond to the gospel message of Jesus Christ, who saved us from the anguish of hell that is to come, that has brought us to the place where we that will bring us future day to a place we'll look at next week where there will be zero weeping, zero crying, zero pain. I keep being reminded when I run with Enoch of what it was like to run when I was a little bit younger and you didn't have as much pain when you ran. The only worst thing is when you have the 14-year-old running next to you going, come on, it's not that bad.
Really?
We could slow down.
No.
Okay. Now, while Jesus may not come back today, while today may not be the day Jesus comes back, we are to be ready as if it were this day. And Sprinkle and Chan talk about in the book, there's two parts to God's will. Are you ready? Now, I'm still chewing on this, but it seems logical to me. There's God's decreed will and God's moral will. Let's unpack that for just a second. God's moral will can be resisted. God's decreed will cannot be resisted. So here's what God's moral will is. Let's give an example here from the Old Testament. There's a guy by the name of Samson. And Samson loved girls. He loved girls from Philistine. God told him not. God told the Israelites not to marry women from the Philistines. Samson wanted her anyway. And then there's this little verse in the book of Judges that God said he allowed it to happen to carry out his will against the Philistines. So even though Samson was going against God's moral will, God's decreed will was going to eventually come out. Let me give you a New Testament example. Now let me bring it to today example. In the New Testament, in James chapter 1, verse 27. In James chapter 1, verse 27, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this. Look after orphans, look after widows in their distresses, and to do what? Yeah, that underlined section right there. To keep oneself from being polluted by the world. You put that word polluted right there, anything that stained you in this world. Now, this may not be your vice, but it might be some people's vices in here. We talked about this last Sunday night in my adult and teen class. In the last 5 years, the adult entertainment industry has increased 55% in the United States alone. They are estimated this year alone to make $1.1 billion. This year alone. Now here's what that looks like to those of us who cannot comprehend $1.1 billion. Let's say that you make $12.50 an hour. Okay? You make $100 a day. You don't have to pay taxes. You don't owe anything to anybody. You don't have any bills. You make $100 a day. A day. It's going to take you 27,397 and a quarter years to make $1 billion. 27,300 years to make $1 billion. I don't plan on living over 100. I'm just going to throw that out. If I keep running, I may not see that. But God's moral decree is that you and I would keep ourselves unstained. Now let's look at God's decreed will, if you will, while time permits me. Now I have all these scriptures up here on this. I'm going to have them all up here for you. This is what the description of hell looks like in the New Testament. Time forbids me to talk through all of these. So I'm just going to give them to you. It looks like a place of torment. Revelation 20, verse 10. It looks like a place of second death. Whatever that looks like. Revelation 20, verse 14. It is a place of punishment. Matthew 25, 46. It is a place of separation. 2 Thessalonians 1, 9. It's a place where you will perish. Matthew 10, 28. It's a place of gnashing of teeth. Matthew 8:12. It's a place of darkness. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 17. It's a place of destruction. 1 Thessalonians 5:3. It's a place of fire. Matthew 5:22. And the worm does not die. Mark 9:44. Those are descriptors. Now, listen, friends, and I need you to hear this. Without Jesus, this is what it's going to look like. Without Jesus, this is what it's going to feel like. I once preached a sermon. This was before my time here at Mountain View, called Hell No, I Don't Want to Go. Name of the sermon. And I used an example of feeling, you know, just in part, hell. And I will always remember this. In fact, my kids and the dermatologist says I still need to use sunscreen when I'm out in the sun, and I still work on it. But I remember when I was in fourth grade, I went to the city pool, and I spent all day at the city pool. And I came home and I looked like Bob the Tomato. And then my friend invited me to the pool the next day. Guess where Eric went the next day and spent another 6 hours out in the sun? I still remember having to sleep on my stomach for 2 weeks. I still remember having to get up in the middle of the night and change sheets from all the pus in the water. I still remember the pain of what that felt like. And listen, guys, that's on earth. That was my own stupidity. That wasn't God's decreed will on me. And then my least favorite story, and I know I've shared this one before, is of what smell, the smell of hell. Now, I don't know what the smell of rotten flesh for all eternity is going to smell like. And the worst I can possibly get to the worst smell that I've probably had in my life was when my brothers, well, one of my brothers and a few friends and I, in ignorance, decided we were going to go swimming in the city lagoon. Because, listen, I said in ignorance. I said in ignorance. Because I lived in a town of 100 people, and it was right behind the softball field, and we had just got done playing softball all afternoon. Well, it was actually baseball. Like, dude, I'm going to go swimming. Looking back, I remember coming home and my mom going, "What on earth? Where have you been?" And we told her, and she told us to promptly take our clothes off outside. I don't care if the neighbors see you in your God-given birthday suit. You march to the bathroom. You take a bath. And then a switch was waiting for me after my bath. Just to drive home the point. You don't swim in there. That's the alternative to choosing Jesus. To deny God is to accept a place in hell. Go back to the word condemnation, because that's really what it is. When we don't accept Jesus Christ, condemnation is all we have to look forward to. In the book of Romans, chapter 5. In the book of Romans, chapter 5, I think I've got this verse up there. Yeah, verse 18. This is what Paul says. Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people. Look at what the next half of that verse says. So also one righteous act resulted in justification. One sin results in condemnation. Brought out for the entire world. And now according to Romans 3, none of us are guiltless in it. We all at some point fail God's glory. And then Paul further in Romans chapter 8 verse 1 reminds the church at Rome that therefore there is no condemnation for those in Jesus Christ. Listen, with Jesus we don't have to experience that. Even if right now for a little while we have some troubles on this earth, we don't have to worry about an eternity and all of that. There are so many questions that we could ask and try to answer when it comes to the word hell. But the truth is, there's a way out of hell, and his name is Jesus Christ. So I did promise I was going to talk about a couple of words of hell. One of those that Jesus uses in the New Testament is Gehenna. It's an interesting place in the Old Testament. This word Gehenna actually comes from a valley or a ravine south of Jerusalem. And 2 Kings and 2 Chronicles and 1 Kings, it's associated with pagan worship, where people would bring their children onto an altar and sacrifice them to a god, and to drown out the sound of those children screaming, "We're going to beat on a drum." Hopefully we don't hear the kids screaming. We do the same thing today. Car's making a funny noise. Just turn the radio up. The valley would be known as Hinnom. And by the time we get to Jesus, he used that place to give them a picture image, a smell, using every senses of what hell looks like. And he quotes it in Matthew 5 and in Matthew 10 and other places. And it's going to be absolutely miserable for all those to accept that faith. Is going to be a root for all those to accept that faith, that fate. Man, you are in for a rude awakening. In the New Testament, along with Gehenna, we would find the word Tartarus. It's only used one time in the entire Bible. It's in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4. And Peter uses it, not in a good sense. "For God did not spare angels when they sinned, but he cast them into Tartarus, putting them in chains of darkness to be held judgment." It sure seems like this is a place where some of them are right now. And they're waiting, for they know exactly where they're going. The second death. And then there's the final word, which is Hades. And I'm still chewing on this Hades word, because I'm not 100% sure what it is. It almost seems like it's an intermediate state. I don't know that for sure. It's not a full conclusion I've come to. But you're going to find that some people are going to use that word Hades as kind of an intermediate state, which is where you're going to go and hang out until the judgment day, before the final hell. But what makes the words condemnation and salvation so uniquely the same in one sense is their final results. They are final results. And if there's any one thing I want to drive home this morning, is that there's a finality to everything we say and everything we do. We're either going to build people up or we're going to tear people down. We're either going to preach heaven or we're not going to preach it. We're going to show hell or we're not going to show it. Ecclesiastes 12:14, Solomon writes, "For God is going to bring about every act to judgment, including every hidden thing, whether good or bad." In the New Testament, it's the same sentiment is echoed in Revelation chapter 20, verses 11 and 12, when John writes to the church in Revelation, when he says, "I saw a great white throne, and I saw books were opened, and the dead were judged from the things that were written down in the books according to their deeds." According to your deeds, whatever you say, whatever you do. And I do not believe that John saw something that wasn't truthful. Not allegorical, not symbolic, but absolutely 100% truthful. So how do I get out of it? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. One day when Vice President Calvin Coolidge was presiding over the Senate, one senator angrily told him to go straight to hell. The offended senator complained to Coolidge as president officer, And then Cal, another guy, looked up from his book that he had been leafing through while listening to the whole debate. And he goes, you know, been looking through the rule book. You don't have to go there. Friends, if we're looking at the rule book, we know we don't have to go there. You see, Jesus and the disciples, they're walking along and they're heading to Jerusalem. And Jesus goes, hey guys, who do you say I am? Who do people say I am? Oh, well, you know, one of the prophets. Oh, you're like Jeremiah or Isaiah, somebody. No. Who do you say I am? And Peter replies, and I think I have this verse up there, don't I? Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. And look at what Jesus says right immediately after that. Do I have that up there? Yeah, next slide. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. Upon that statement, we could argue about who he was talking about, what he was talking to. I don't care. We're not about that this morning. What we're about right now is that upon that moment in your life, when you said, I believe, Jesus, that you are the Son of the living God, hell no longer has dominion over you. Death no longer has sting over you. Now it's Jesus Christ, and it's life eternal through him. And if you want to look at what that looks like, we're going to go there next week. But this morning, right now in this place, friends, the rule book is very clear. God's decreed will is very clear. And if you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and if you've never publicly confessed Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and if you've never put Jesus on and clothed Jesus, I invite you to do that right now as we stand together and we sing together this last song. We stand.
My Jesus.